Welcome to European News Weekly. I have myself, Sean McGee, and Jimmy Hagen, my co-host. Today I'd like to welcome Timothy Mousseau, and he's basically been doing studies in the Chernobyl and Fukushima environments, looking at the effect and distribution of contaminants within the sort of areas of the nuclear disasters. So I'd like to welcome you. Hi, Tim. This is great to have you on board.
Well, thanks very much. Pleasure to be here.
So I think we just had a little bit of a pre-talk there, and actually, I you picked up a point there, which I'm quite interested in. Now, you obviously have a hell of a lot of studies out. You've been talking on various platforms about the situation. There's been much discussion, both from the pro sort of nuclear, if I want to call them that, and the more activisty nuclear, anti-nuclear, and all the shades in between. And we've been talking. Obviously, the basic thing is that you have discovered contaminants in sort of wildlife in these areas, and you've basically seen that there's sort of effects on the wildlife. So, and we were talking about this just before we started. So, and the point that came up, which I'm going to come straight to, actually, we were talking about levels of contaminants or radiological contaminants in these species. And you kind of brought up a point that in Chernobyl, there was strontium and even plutonium found in these animals in maybe small amounts, but certainly they are there. And what I'd like to know, and I think other people out there would like to know, is have these contaminants been found in Fukushima Prefecture, where the nuclear disaster was?
Well, that's a really good question, and luckily, if you can say anything lucky about the disaster in Fukushima, it is that the contaminants were pretty much limited to large amounts of noble gases, krypton and xenon, which dissipated pretty quickly. The iodine that was released, that was a huge problem initially, but it also dissipated relatively quickly. And really leaving just isotopes of cesium, cesium-134 and cesium-137, which are, they have a very long lifespan, but, very long half-life of, about 30 years, but they're not potentially as toxic as some of the other isotopes that exist. Luckily, the plutonium releases were very, very, very small. I think there have been a few samples where they've detected plutonium and some isotopes of silver and perhaps a few other isotopes, but most of those other isotopes are, in very, very small quantities relative to the cesium that was released. That's very different to the Chernobyl situation, where huge quantities of strontium, about equal cesium and strontium, in fact, released, along with several isotopes of plutonium. The plutonium is in the process of decaying into americium-241 right now, and this americium is actually leading to a relative increase in the radioactivity of the area, at least in terms of by virtue of the fact that the americium is particularly radioactive, more radioactive than the plutonium parent. So, the two situations in Japan and Chernobyl are quite different in a lot of ways. Very, very fortunate for the people of Japan. It could have been much, much worse.
Well, that's interesting. So what basically, when we're sort of looking at the isotopes, and the real isotopes to watch out for are the cesium-134 and cesium-137. And what about strontium-90 or the other strontium isotopes?
So in Japan, because the strontium is a metal at lower temperatures, it wasn't volatilized. Because the temperatures were relatively low during the disaster, it wasn't volatilized to the same extent as the cesium and the iodine and the noble gases that were released. So it didn't go very far. Of course, right now the problem is that the groundwater and the cooling water that's being generated at the plant, they are leaking into the ocean, and they carry large quantities of strontium. So the marine contaminant situation is completely different and potentially much more serious than the terrestrial contamination picture.
I think this is probably outside your field, but certainly considering the marine sort of contamination, obviously people are sort of always worried about it making its way to the U.S. West Coast. But if you look at the sort of the geology and the marine biology off the coast of Japan for quite some miles, maybe 100 miles or so, there's a shelf and there's many sort of mounds, and there's also cracks in the ground, and many fish species actually grow there, develop there. It's their sort of birthing place. Has anybody, do you know if anybody who's had a look at those areas, those very vital areas for the sustainability of the Japanese fisheries, I should imagine?
Yeah, no, that's a really good question. And, certainly there's been a huge monitoring effort to determine which of the species are most contaminated, and several of the species, especially the species that live on the surface of the sediments, show very serious contamination levels above what we would accept for export from Japan, for instance, for human consumption. And this is a big problem. As far as I know, there's not been any real published research related to the impacts on the fish themselves. That most of the work that's been done is again surveillance work to determine whether or not the fish can be consumed, rather than the biological impacts, the potential genetic and evolutionary impacts, ecological impacts of the contaminants on the fisheries itself. I think that's a really important question, and of course that's one of the interests we have as a group.
Okay, so obviously you've got the sediment. As you go out to sea, you've got a kind of a shelf, and you've got sediment there, and you've got fish there as well, and various fish that live on that as well. But obviously there's like nursery areas where there's like little hills, and especially in the deep sea, when you go off the shelf of Japan. So basically they're sort of like these little mounds and crevices, as I was saying, and they're the kind of nurseries. There's a lot of fish species sea life that inhabit these sort of little islands in that area. So you're saying there's been no studies in that deeper part of the ocean?
You'd have to talk to some of the folks that are involved in the surveillance efforts. But as far as I know, there's been minimal effort to study the biological impacts. Again, most of the work has been focused on just determining whether or not the fish is below regulatory limits for export. That's the main, economic driver for the interest. But the biological work has been almost nil as far as I can tell.
Okay, and let's get back onto the land area. Now, obviously, I suspect that you've been doing the slightly more hotter areas, which are going northwest of the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant towards Fukushima City. That's heading towards the mountains as well. We'll come back to what you found there, I think, because obviously there's a lot of well documented stuff that you've put up, and it's quite interesting studies that you've done. But going up into the mountains, where when the plume hit, it also contaminated it. Although it saved the mountains, saved the eastern part of the western part of Japan. The actual mountain itself had quite a big hit, and it from the water samples that we're getting now, it seems to be, from my perspective, it seems to be that some of that cesium that's up in those mountains that is starting to come down via the water courses. What has anybody done studies of wildlife up in those more remote places, up in the mountains, and certainly the east slope off Japan?
Yeah, there's a little bit of research going on by folks in Japan, and of course our team has been doing a fair bit of work on the birds and the rodents and the insects and some of the plants and even some of the microbial communities in the area. Most of our work is indeed up in the mountainous side of Fukushima, sort of between Fukushima City itself and the coast, up and down the mountains. We're actually looking at, you know, the areas of highest contamination, right, you know, in Namiya and the Hidate regions. But we're also looking at similar ecological habitats that were much less impacted by the radiation, so that we have sort of comparisons to draw upon, so that we can look at how things look when it's relatively normal with respect to radiation compared to the impacts when the radiation hits these environments. And yeah, over the last, you know, 5 years now, we've published on the order of 8 or 9, you know, data papers, primary papers, investigating the impacts on birds, insects, and we're just starting to get the work on rodents out the door. You'll see a few publications this spring related to the impacts on the mice in the area, for instance. Just this past year, we've also set up a bunch of cameras to monitor the larger mammals in the area, the wild boar, and most of the so-called wild boar are actually domestic pigs crossed with wild boar. So there's a kind of a range of pig-like critters roaming through the zone at the moment.
That's wild. It is wild. Yeah, of course.
Yeah, that's great. Lots and lots of these pigs and lots of monkeys. And so we're starting to get a handle on what the impacts are on these larger animals as well in these very radioactive areas.
Sure. And when you're saying that you're looking a little bit wider, I did a little article on Ose National Park, just north of Chiba, or on the edge of the Fukushima Prefecture, southern end.
Yeah.
It's a lovely big wildlife park there. It goes up in stages. There's lots of water courses and wildlife. And I discovered that it certainly got hit. So they were measuring on a Geiger counter, 0.5 microsieverts that I saw. So there's obviously been some sort of hit there. Have you, and actually TEPCO actually own it. I think they've got the larger share of it. So have you checked that area out at all?
Yeah, we certainly have. And
you know, how did that go, dare I ask?
Well, you know, we were very disappointed originally when we started doing our surveys, because we'd hoped to be able to find some areas in Fukushima that were, you know, clean, that didn't have any contamination at all, and we were really unable to find any areas that hadn't been affected to some degree by the contaminants, but we did find areas like the region you mentioned that has relatively lower levels, you know, less than 0.5 microsieverts per hour, which is, you know, relative to the 30, 40, 50 microsieverts per hour that we see up in the mountains where we're doing work. That's a 100-fold less, and so that gives us sufficient range of radiation levels to do the sorts of experimental studies that we've been doing. But yeah, it's very difficult to find a true control area in the region, you know, an area that hasn't been affected at least to some degree by the radiation.
Okay, so you've got 40 to 50 microsieverts an hour, which is quite a lot, up in the mountains, and of course, when you come down the mountains, you come onto Ose National Park. Do you anticipate an increase in cesium in the lakes and in the wildlife around there in decades to come?
Yeah, so it's very clear. There actually is a fair bit of research being done by geologists right now, looking at sediment transport down through the streams, down through the mountainsides. I think this is of particular interest given, you know, the massive disturbance that's been going on around Fukushima to, you know, remove the top layer of soil in these regions that they're hoping to entice people to move back to. And so there's a lot of sediment movement via water, via the rain. In fact, we were there last October sampling mice, and we got hit by a typhoon, and there was about 12 inches, 15 inches of rain that fell in 12 hours while we were there, sort of washing out roads, and you could see, you know, the impact of the erosion of the landside of the landscape with, you know, all the movement of the sediments down through the rivers. And clearly that's going to be showing up in the lakes and the streams along the way, and it's going to be having some impact far and wide, and there is ongoing concern, in fact, in the the marine fisheries at the outflows from these rivers, where the sediment's coming in, that there's concern that these fisheries will continue to be impacted by this input of contaminants from the mountainsides for decades to come.
I mean, now you're talking about that, we've got climate change, we've got hotter seas, we've got greater, more persevering storms, so that we have to bear that in mind. And also, when we're looking at this situation in the mountain, these 40 and 50 microsieverts per hour sort of measurements that you're getting, which is obviously a hell of a lot of becquerels in soil. You're saying that basically it's getting swept down, and obviously Ozay National Park is a layer of plateaus with lakes on. And one would imagine that the heavier sediment as it comes down will settle in these lakes. And has there been any studies done to get a sort of a basic measurement in these sediments, and also in the wildlife, the insects that actually live in the soil or on the shoreline of off these lakes and rivers?
Yeah, I don't know of any specific studies going on. I was actually in Fukushima last September as well, and there was a conference in Fukushima City where they had quite a large number of geologists from around the world who descended upon Fukushima to draft up a plan to conduct research of the sort you're describing. I'm presuming that we'll start to see the results of these kinds of studies in the next year or two.
Are they independent studies like yourself? You're an independent from the nuclear. You're an academic. So are these academics, or do you think these may be academics that maybe get funding from the nuclear industry?
I don't think a lot of academics get funding from the nuclear industry. For some reason, they don't want to fund us. I'm not sure why, but
I can tell you why. No,
no, you won't. But,
I've been hoping for a big grant from a nuclear source for years, but it's never come. But anyway,
what I hear is that the nuclear industry is going down the pan, certainly in the UK and France. So maybe when that happens, maybe they'll need to put some funding into something else other than whatever they're putting it into at the moment.
Yeah. The folks that I ran into in the hotel where I was staying actually were independent scientists from Canada and the U.S. and, academic scientists. And I think they were largely self-funded at that point, but I think they were hoping to put grant proposals together and to fund some unsolicited research. Clearly needs to be done, and the more people who get involved, the better.
Do the Japanese fund any of this research?
They're funding various groups to certain extents. Again, most of the funding that's going to Fukushima is related to the surveillance operation to ensure or to measure the levels of contamination in foodstuffs, and also some of the medical surveillance that's being done, especially related to thyroid cancers and that kind of thing. Not a whole lot of research for independent funding for independent scientists at other academic institutions. There hasn't been any special calls for Fukushima research, and so there's really just a handful of independent scientists who've managed to find their way into this region to do independent research. The big issue with most academic scientists is that they just don't have the resources to do it unless there's a grant, and so if there's no grant, then it just doesn't get done.
And of course, you're basically going over there, and then you go to Chernobyl, and then you go and you have to do your papers, and then you have to fight, I suppose, with the peer review process. How does the peer review process? Do you find that you really get? I mean, for instance, Ian Fairley spent 2 years trying to get a paper out because it was saying that nuclear power stations cause leukemia in children. Do you find a similar issue?
You know, it's always a constant battle, and I suppose that's the real positive aspect of the peer review process is that it's not easy to publish anything in any field. It's a real battle all the time, and that's part of the process, and that's what keeps us all honest to some extent. But yeah, the downside is that occasionally there are especially something that's at the edge, on the edge, or in a field that there aren't a lot of people working in, it's often very difficult to find reviewers who are sufficiently knowledgeable and sufficiently open-minded to consider these more creative kinds of studies. This has been an issue for the last couple of decades as we, move towards these multidisciplinary, interdisciplinary kinds of studies, and it's just a challenge getting qualified people to do the reviews. But yeah, with great effort and perseverance, we have managed to publish most of our studies without. At least eventually, we've published about 80 papers in the last 10 years or so. And so, that's certainly testimony to the fact that it can be done, sure. But it is a lot of work.
Yeah, and thank you for doing it. Now, we'll stick with the peer review process here for a minute. I do blogging so as well, and I'm a bit of an anti-nuclear troll. I put my hands up. And so what I did, I was having a chat with some pro-nuclear types concerning Professor Tsuda, who brought out a thyroid study. And of course, I was saying, well, that study's really good. But he was the only guy that counted it up, and he actually went to the bother of doing it. And anyway, they're all connected with the Yahoo sort of Pentagon nuclear sort of health physicists. There's about, I think there's about 20 to 40 of them. It's hard to say because they have lots of different names anyway. I was having a chat with one of them, and he goes, oh, no, and it's all wrong, and this and this and this. And he gave me a list of about 6 points why Professor Tsuda was wrong. So he then challenged me to contact Professor Tsuda and ask him, he said. And so I did. I thought, oh, yeah, right, I'm going to do this. And I sent the questions to Professor Tsuda on a Friday, and on a Sunday I got them back. So God bless him. All the answers, I put those onto a blog, and then I went back to Japan Times, gave them a little heads up, said I've done the study, and I would say they gave it about 24 hours, and they came back with another list of about 8 questions. Now, my point being is that if they had those 8 questions already, plus the 6 they gave me, why didn't they give me all 14 to start off with? So the point being here is that in the peer review process, they could turn around, they could say, look, here's our argument, here's your argument. But what they don't do that, what happens is you give your argument and they knock a few bits off. And you spend time, you do your thing, and then send it off, and you wait around, and then they bring it back, and then they ask you some more. And then the whole process, and it takes years. So this is what happened to Ian Fairley. They didn't lay all their cards on the table. They held some back to delay the peer review process. Now, has anything like that happened to you?
Well, I frankly think you're giving these folks way too much credit and for forethought. I don't really think it works exactly that way. I don't think they're that.
It only took 24 hours of them to come up with another 8. So, but anyway, we'll move on.
Yeah, it's just sort of, it's an imperfect process, and it's just better than the alternative, and nobody's come up with a better alternative.
I totally agree. I just think it's a shame that it can it sometimes delayed and made much more difficult. If they wanted to in terms of strategy, playing chess or whatever.
No, I agree with that, yeah. Certainly. And it certainly slowed us down greatly from time to time. And it's frustrating as heck. And but yeah, it's just it really is the best that we have, the best model we have for moving knowledge forward at this point. Yeah. And so, yeah, you just have to live with it to some extent. But now if these people are really, truly being disingenuous and dishonest, then that's something else. You know, I think that's a different issue. And if there's a way to reveal that, then that's worth pursuing. You know,
I certainly will.
Yeah.
All right. So I think we've covered the peer review thing, and we've just given people something to think about. Maybe coming on to funding. Going back to funding. Sorry. Mm. Obviously, you obviously do get some funding, thank heavens. When we're talking about doing studies on the ground in Fukushima, is there problems? So, say for instance, Ken Busler, he basically said, "Right, we're going to check the water. We're going to see if it's contaminated. We're going to, you know, we're going to measure it." And he put a crowdsource out, and he also asked people to actually participate in this. So he got money. And not only that, but he got on-the-ground workers who could take samples. So when we take that, if we were to take that that format, and we were to put that into Japan, and we were to sort of look at the fact that because of the secrets law that came in, that, you know, if people talk about Fukushima, they could go to prison. It's only a threat, but it's on the books. There is a secrets law. I don't know if they've hit anybody with it. But it puts a lot of fear into people. And I personally know that Japanese in UK have been harassed and attacked for their anti-nuclear activities. I could guess that is definitely happening in Japan. There is a sort of kind of suppression. Even if you don't apply the law, it still stops you having your free speech, basically. So, with that in mind, you know, if you were to set up something similar in Japan, in fact, could you set up something similar like that in Japan, given the situation? Are the people you know there, could they do the samples? Could they go around taking little samples of soil or catching some flies or bugs or four-legged critters or whatever it is? I'll leave the door open to you to have a wee talk about that kind of thing.
Yeah, no, really good question. And you know, want to start by saying that Insular's done a fabulous job at raising public awareness and getting citizen scientists involved in the process. But the funds that he's raised come nowhere near the cost of doing the science. They barely pay for the shipping and processing of the samples. And so this really is just a very limited effort. It doesn't in any way provide the level of information that we really need to address the bigger question. But that said, he's doing a fabulous job with what he's got at hand to do it.
Yeah, totally.
You know, in Fukushima and in Chernobyl, one of the problems, the real difficulty with enlisting citizen scientists to get involved, is that, well, first of all, it's kind of a dangerous place. You don't really want, you know, the middle schoolers out there collecting dirt from these radioactive areas, do you? And so, you know, it's not something that you can really enlist, the lay public to get involved in because of the hazards associated with it. The other aspect is, of course, there's a big fence around this area, and it actually is a rather involved and difficult process to gain permission to do work in these areas. Both Chernobyl and Fukushima have a very long involved permit process that really make it an option for folks who are engaged in some level of serious activity. So the citizen scientist component of this really is not available for that kind of research activity, that certainly the kind that we're doing anyway in these areas of high contamination. In terms of the secrets law, I believe this really only really only applies to journalists. I don't think it applies to common citizens doing their day-to-day thing. But that said, I do think there is an awful lot of what I would call self-censorship going on in Japan, in that people are, you know, being quite restrained in their comments and concerns and not getting involved in any kind of protest for the most part. And it is a very conservative society, by and large. But that said, we've been working there for 5 years, and this past year, we've been invited to stay and live with people who have homes in the region, so that we could be, staying close up to where our field sites are. People have volunteered to cook for us and to help us with translation and interpretation. People who have homes, who still have homes inside these most radioactive areas, have volunteered their farmhouses and barns for us to do our work in. And so, that level of citizen participation is certainly very important for our work. And of course, we've also had quite a number of donations from individual Japanese citizens who've been supportive of our research in many different ways, including financially. Again, it's just a spit in the bucket in terms of the costs. And I certainly could share with you a lot of creative ways that we've gotten the funding. But I did want to address the issue you bring up, the censorship issue. And one of my current theses is that there's a sort of an insidious form of censorship going on that most people aren't aware of. They're not really tuned into it, and that's the fact that if you don't fund science, if you don't provide resources for research to get done, it doesn't get done. And as a consequence, questions are not asked, they're certainly not answered. Most scientists are, truly craftsmen, and they employ their skills to address these scientific questions, but they can't do it unless they get paid, unless they pay their salaries, unless they can pay for the salaries of the people who work for them, unless they can pay for the lab materials and supplies. And so it's a very large enterprise, and this is one of the reasons that, for instance, in the United States, the National Science Foundation has a budget of something approaching $8 or $9 billion a year. The National Institutes of Health research budget is, tens of billions of years a year. Research is expensive, and so if you don't fund it, this really does limit the knowledge that can be gained on a given topic.
So, what do you reckon on crowdsourcing? What's the possibilities of marketing for crowdsourcing? Have you tried it? Is it difficult? What results, if you have?
I haven't tried the sort of conventional crowdsourcing approach. The main issue is that, it, as far as I can tell, based on my colleagues who've tried it, it doesn't provide enough funding to get the job done. And the operation that I'm running in Chernobyl and Fukushima, costs on the order of several $100,000 a year to maintain. And so, the only sources of funding that can provide that level of investment are really government sources or institutional sources. But that said, I haven't had much luck with some of the other more conventional sources. So maybe I'll try the crowdsourcing route and see how it goes. If you have any tips, let me know.
Well, obviously, we're it's at the moment, in terms of blogging, we find it very hard. Like on Facebook, we get blocked and sidetracked. Google and YouTube, YouTube hasn't been too bad actually, but certainly we've noticed that with Google searches and things, sometimes those are very difficult if you're kind of an activist and a non-payer. Same in Facebook, if you're not paying for adverts, you don't get those boosts of numbers. The amount of posts you put up, you get small amounts. But having said that, though, that combined all the different social media, it is possible, I should imagine, to try and raise some money. But I would recommend it, because I'm sure, if you got some, that would be some. Maybe if people had the option pay for your, you know, pay, help pay for your research, that just to, for the sake of opening a PayPal account and having a fundraiser account, and then basically, you know, every time you bring out a sort of a paper, you, you know, do a radio show, or, you know, you just say, look, we've got fundraising, and publicize it. We can only hope that the media will sometimes pick up on these things, but they tend to pick up more on the negative aspects. I think at the end of the day, it's a difficult one, but I think it's certainly worth a try. I know that your work is, in my opinion, is incredibly important, because we will definitely not get the money for studies for human beings. And I think Professor Suda would agree. It would be, you know, and in fact, actually in Japan, you were saying that, you know, censorship only applies to journalists, but it also applies to health workers as well. Because from my point of view, there was polydactyl. From my point of view, there was nosebleeds and all sorts of things from the on-the-ground people that I was talking to. You know, we don't know about cancers or anything else, but certainly before any of those effects became apparent, the polydactyl was just becoming apparent, they closed it down. And, and there was also a blood test that you could do within 3 years, and it could tell if you had some damage due to radiation. But after 3 years, it was useless. And 2.5 years in, Prime Minister Abe turned around and said that he wouldn't do it because it might they might find illegitimate children. He needed to have a discussion about it, and there was only 6 months left for the test to be viable. So there's all that kind of stuff going on, especially with the health effects, and also the secrecy law does apply to that. However, you know, you're studying wildlife, and it seems, thank heavens, that your work is being allowed. And, you know, we can't, I think you've said yourself, you can't tie the health effects to the to the other effects, the human effects. So, but certainly the rest of us can. So, did I say that? Whoops. We can sometimes draw comparisons. Okay, so I mean, we could pop over to Chernobyl. At this point, or pop back there. We were obviously sort of looking at, well, basically, you've done a study recently, and you're obviously going to be drawing this paper up and getting ready for the battle in the peer review sector. Would you like to tell us some of the findings? And it's quite dramatic. I was quite impressed with what you were saying. Would you like to tell us about that upcoming paper?
You know, we keep a steady movement forward. You know, actually, just last week we published a paper. I'll mention that one first. It's one of our first studies on the mice, the rodents of Chernobyl, where we have been monitoring their survival success and diseases in the Chernobyl zone, in both clean areas and in highly radioactive areas. And this first paper documents very clearly increased rates of cataracts in the eyes of these mice, which is, of course, you know, one of the eyes, one of the more sensitive tissues to radiation, and tends to show the effects of radiation soonest. And we previously documented cataracts in the eyes of the birds of the region a couple of years ago. So this was an interesting finding that's sort of supported our ongoing studies of the region. But yeah, we have another paper that's already gone through the review process, so I can tell you that it will be coming out in Trends in Ecology and Evolution. It's basically an analysis of all of the studies, including ours, but many other people's studies, that have attempted to determine whether or not plants and animals and bacteria are actually adapting, you know, evolving to deal with the radiation in the Chernobyl region in the face of these radioactive contaminants. You know, there are a lot of reasons to believe that plants and animals and microbes should be able to adapt to increased levels of radiation. You know, in the past, there's been higher levels of radiation on the surface of the planet. In fact, you know, terrestrial life as we know it didn't evolve until about I think 500 million years ago, when the UV levels actually finally dropped below, you know, really seriously dangerous levels. And so, you know, in the past, the organisms have had to deal with higher radiation levels. So why not? Why shouldn't they evolve now in the face of nuclear disasters? Well, the short story is that we could find no evidence, no significant evidence that plants and animals have in any way been able to, you know, address this increased level of radiation in any adaptive way. There doesn't seem to be any positive evolution response to the radiation. All of the effects pretty much seem to be negative. And this really wasn't that surprising to us, because, you know, biologically it's just not, you know, animals and plants, organisms are constantly facing mutations, and just as a result of day-to-day life, and they're trying to deal with these mutations as best they can. Radiation comes along and just contributes an additional mutational load that has to be repaired or dealt with in some way. And so it's not really surprising to us that there really is no way to be better at it, at least not without some other cost. So that's the basic finding. It'll be out in probably about a month from now. I'll certainly send you a link to it when it comes out.
Fantastic, and I'll definitely do an article and spread it around. while we're talking about this, and I did an article a while ago, which you generously, you know, it was to do with Science Daily, talking about the fact that how wonderful it was that animals were adapting and so on and so on. And of course, when I sent you that article, you sent it back. So basically, you sent a reply back, and I did a study. You know, we sort of kind of clarified this point, you know, that, and I think you said that although some sort of species seem to be sort of doing well, I think it was particularly black birds or birds with black pigment.
Yeah.
In this study, is there any change to that aspect? I know you also said there was a complete disaster with the rest of the wildlife, but with this particular issue that Science Daily picked up on, do you kind of stand by that? Is that still a situation that sort of?
Yeah. No. It does. And so the basic finding from that study was that the organisms can, you know, either use these antioxidants to reduce the mutational load, or they can use it to advertise to a mate or defend against some other disease. But there's this ultimate trade-off that limits their success in one way or another. And that's really the main story.
Sure. So in terms of the evolution of these birds, it would be the case that, you know, given climate change as well and their general evolution anyway, that the evolutionary process within these birds may be stopped, you know, so they can't change their pigment and their color because of the antioxidants. How does that pan out? What do you think about that?
Yeah, no, that's certainly one possibility, you know, given that some of these pigments are used for thermal regulation, you know, to conserve heat or to absorb heat. That's certainly one hypothesis that could be tested, and it seems likely that might be involved for at least some of these organisms. But that, you know, that's sort of one of the basic rules of evolutionary biology is that there are always trade-offs. You know, if we could do better universally, we probably would be doing better. You know, evolution has tested most of the permutations that exist and found the ones that seem to work best under most circumstances. But there's always a reassortment and change as the environment changes as well.
Sure. And the other thing I was going to bring up was, you know, obviously I've been annoying the nuclear industry for some time now. And one of the annoying things I did was contact Geraldine Thomas because I was looking at Chernobyl Children International and their claim that there's an effect, and it's on the on their charity status, their statement of a fact that Chernobyl, the radiation from Chernobyl, is causing problems in the hearts of young children and this pinholes specifically. So have you come across any findings where possibly there's been pinholes or in the heart, or if there's been effects in that area.
Yeah, that's a really good question. You know, I think it's pretty well recognized that there is a broad array of cardiovascular issues associated with radiation exposure. I think there have been quite a number of studies in Ukraine and Belarus that have made that, you know, identified that association, not just in children, but in adults as well, especially, you know, the liquidators that got large doses. And so, you know, that kind of research is worth pursuing. And we haven't looked yet at the mice for that particular kind of effect, but I think, you know, given what you just said, I think we'll probably make it a priority to go back through our samples and see what we can find. That seems to be a good thing to look for.
That's fantastic. Right. So, well, I'd just like to, we can sort of kind of finish up here, I suppose, because it's been quite long. It's been absolutely amazing information you've given, and it's been well delivered. Thank you so much for that. But just to finish off, is there anything?
Before we finish up, Sean, right, can I just ask one or two questions?
By all means, crack one.
Yeah. Thanks, buddy. Now, at the beginning of your interview, Timothy, we were talking about Chernobyl and we were talking about Fukushima. And you kind of sort of hinted at the fact that Chernobyl was so much more worse than Fukushima. Would you give us a little bit of an idea as to why that comes about?
Yeah, well, you know, again, let me qualify that by saying I'm speaking just about the effects on terrestrial systems and largely, of course, on the people that were exposed. You know, the Chernobyl disaster released, again, enormous quantities of radionuclides across Europe, Eastern and Western Europe and Scandinavia, affecting many more people than were directly impacted in Japan. And so at that scale, you know, the terrestrial scale, the Chernobyl disaster was much larger. Now, I'm not talking about the impacts to the marine environment where there's an ongoing ongoing disaster and where most of the radionuclides from Fukushima ended up. And we really have just a minimal idea of what the potential impacts will be in the long run on the marine side. But from a terrestrial point of view and from a human point of view, the impacts of the Fukushima disaster were considerably lower, not just because of the amounts, but also because it was limited to a much smaller range of radionuclides, radionuclides that are generally considered to be a little less dangerous in terms of their toxicity. So the other aspect, we actually wrote a paper last year, the group published a paper last year showing that, you know, if the Fukushima disaster had occurred at any other time of the year in 2011, the impacts on the terrestrial side would have been much, much larger. You know, Tokyo would have been basically doused with radioactivity. Many more millions of people would have been doused with significant amounts of contamination. It was just, again, just incredibly fortuitous that it occurred in March and that the wind was blowing most out to sea, at least in terms of the people of Japan. So that's what I was getting at when I was saying that.
I'd like to qualify that as well, if I might. I did some study on the meteorological effects around Japan, and I think about once or twice a year, the polar winds come down, and they actually push all the sort of the winds come from the north, and it actually pushes it even beyond the equator. So it actually breaks the equator, it would have ended up going directly to Australia, basically, and certainly straight across Tokyo. And obviously, the Prime Minister Kan basically said that Tokyo got off lightly, although we've obviously discussed the fact that radiation got there, and it got there with in various plumes during that time. There was a couple of vector paths, but as you were saying, it was we had a strong kind of westerly wind coming in. But okay, sorry, Jimmy, you were going to ask another question.
Yeah, I've just got one more now, and it actually concerns the removal of topsoil, right? And because for example, I'm really into gardening, and I'm into horticulture and stuff like that. And to me, the idea of removing topsoil doesn't seem to be a solution as such, because when you remove the topsoil, no matter how radioactive radioactively it's contaminated, like you're removing the basis for all future life in the soil, because like the subsoil itself doesn't really support much life. So any thoughts on that, Timothy?
Yeah, no, of course you're right. And the only real comment is that, you know, they're only doing this for about a 20-foot section on either sides of the roads and around the homes. So they're really only carting off a very small amount of the soil that, you know, would lead to high radiation measurements on the roadsides as people are passing. And so it's really kind of a superficial cleanup in that regard. And of course, because the plants, you know, are transpiring, you know, they're bringing water up from the soil through their roots up to the leaves, and the leaves, you know, concentrate the cesium, and the leaves then drop to the ground every fall or different times of the year, depending on the species. There's going to be a regrowth of the soil along with the contaminants in that soil. So it's not going to disappear for all that long, especially given that, you know, these roads sides tend to be in the valleys, and so there's going to be constant movement of the sediment and the contaminants along with the water down towards these lower areas from the mountainsides. You know, you're absolutely right. There's an issue with removing the topsoil, but it, you know, in the end, it's a really superficial attempt to provide this appearance of reduced contamination, but it's really not the solution to the problem in the area.
Well, that's actually quite interesting. I'd just like to take another step onto that, just a very quick one, if I might. Obviously, they take the topsoil away, and they have got absolutely masses of it, even though there's only taking a small percentage of it. What happens with the leaves? They drop, and are they biodegrading? Are you having any similar situations that you found in Chernobyl where things are not biodegrading, and in which case they're just going to sort of be blown around and end back up on top of whatever surface is there? Have you got any sort of a take on that?
Yeah, it's a good question. You know, we actually just finished that experiment. We went and redid that same experiment that we'd done in Chernobyl. We repeated it in Fukushima, and we're just in the process of getting the data analyzed at this point. We put out leaves, rotting, you know, we put out dead vegetative matter all around the zone, and areas of high contamination, areas of low contamination, different species of plant material, and left it there for a year and recovered them just a few months ago. And now they've been dried and weighed, and now we're starting to analyze to see if, in fact, the microbial activity that would normally, you know, decompose this plant material and recycle the nutrients, to see if it's been affected in the same way that it had been in Chernobyl. We're not entirely sure. You know, first of all, the levels of radioactivity are you know, quite a bit lower in Fukushima in general, and so there might be a reduced effect. Also, as I mentioned earlier, there's a different, a much simpler array of radionuclides in the soil. It's really just cesium-134 and cesium-137 rather than the other isotopes that you can find in Chernobyl that may be important in affecting the microbial community. We just don't know. Call me back in a few months and I should have an answer for you.
We certainly will. and on that note, is there anything else, Jimmy, you'd like to say?
No. I couldn't add anything to that. Like, I was so nervous, right, coming into this interview, because I knew so little about Timothy's work, but I actually feel like I've come out and I've learned something. So I'm going to leave my question at that. And thanks, Timothy, very, very much.
Well, thanks for calling me up. It's been a pleasure chatting with you guys.
Oh, great stuff, mate. And yeah, we'll definitely be in contact with you again. And this is going to be a fantastic podcast. I'll spread it everywhere.
Okay.
All right. God bless, and thank you so much for joining us on European News Weekly.
Pleasure.